Welcome back to my YouTube channel. Today we're going to be talking about bass guitar, and I've got a whole bunch of distortion pedals lined up to shoot out for you in the context of the way I use distortion on the bass and the pedals I like, but also a bunch of other ones, and we'll see how it all works out. So I have a loop that sort of covers a lot of variety, and I'm going to run a whole bunch of distortion pedals, which you can kind of see in the background, through it. You can hear how they sound in this setup with the blend going on. Then afterwards, I'm going to go through all them individually, and I'm going to be playing with the settings and dialing them in and talking about it and playing through solo clips of those.
Thank you.
I've been playing bass for 16 years now, and the last 10 years with my band Myopic, we have done 2 full-length albums now, as well as, 4 EPs, played lots of live shows. I've played bass in some other bands. I've done some studio session stuff. I run my little studio here. I do all the bass work on my own solo projects, of which I have a bunch of releases. So all that to say, you know, I know a thing or two about bass. You know, there's other people who know even more than me, but I've been doing this a long time, and I am a metal bass player primarily. I use distortion or fuzz in my bass signal. And the way I have it routed, whether I'm doing it in the studio or live, is through some channel splitting stuff. So the simple way in the studio I do it is splitting the channels into a distortion and a clean signal. Sometimes I even do a clean lows, maybe just off the DI or through an amp track that is low passed. So I get just the low end, compress the crap out of that, and then go into another channel, which is my distortion, which is usually mid-range focused. Sometimes I even use guitar impulse responses, depends on what I'm doing. And then have a clean track, which is where I get sort of the string articulation, the clank. And that's the basic idea. That's what I do with my live pedal board too. But in this case, it is a mono setup. And let's just walk through that real quick. So here's an overview of my bass pedal board. And I made this one myself. It is a piece of MDF spray painted with some drawer handle pulls on it. And that is sized exactly to fit inside of a rack shelf unit. So my amp is rack mounted, and then I found a shelf unit that fits the whole length of the rack, and I built this to fit just inside of it. So I can put this inside my amp case, take it to a show in one box, and my knobs don't get messed up, and pull it out, throw it on the floor, put it back. It's a genius system, if I do say so myself, and I haven't seen anyone making something like this, just sort of prefab, but it's a cool system that I came up with, and I highly recommend it, and feel free to copy my idea. The pedal board itself probably cost me like $15 in supplies, and then the shelf. Shelves are cheap. Rack shelves are like $30 or something. You know, it's not a sliding drawer or anything. It's just a shelf. So my signal path is a little different as of recently, and I am actually running the input into the Sans amp. That goes to the line selector. That has the effects loop, which contains my drive pedal, and the purpose of the line selector is as a clean distortion blend. So I can mix with those two knobs, the green and red knobs, my clean signal and my whatever distortion pedal I'm using. In this case, I have the bass Big Muff on the board. So I can blend the two of those independently, and then I can turn it on and off. And then that is running to the decimeter, the noise gate, and then to the volume pedal last. And so the volume pedal can control everything after the gate. The idea being that I can do swells with the volume pedal without that activating or deactivating the noise gate. The way I had it routed before, the volume pedal was in front of the noise gate, which is a little bit more typical, but then I had to turn off the noise gate to do any kind of swells with the volume pedal. So yeah, the line selector is kind of the key thing here that I would say makes up maybe what I do a little differently on my bass board. And that's just, yeah, the drive blend. Now, some distortion pedals have a wet mix knob. That is one way to do it, a blend knob, I should say. That would be a fine way to do it if you want to get away with like just one pedal or something, or two pedals. I like the control this gives me, and also the flexibility to use any pedal I want and not have to look for only distortion pedals with a blend knob on it, which a lot of them don't have, especially if they're designed for guitar. So the Sans amp is my preamp that is giving me some pre-EQ and a little bit of overdrive. That shapes the basis of my sound. And then the line selector can toggle between the blend with the drive my distortion sound, that is, or my clean sound, which is just the Sans amp. And the Sans amp does have a little bit of bite to it, but it's mostly clean. I don't have any real need for a perfectly clean bass sound, because I can play chords and everything with the Sans amp and it doesn't get too messy. So that's how I do it. And it's a really flexible setup because, as I said, I can use any distortion pedal I want. And I really like that. And almost anything I find will sound good with this setup because of that clean blend. Don't really have to worry about losing articulation. And then the distortion can really be nasty. And if I need more, if I need to clean it up, I just turn down the distortion level. So I think it's a smart setup. And I've been using it for like 6 years or something now. And it's pretty similar to what I do recording in the studio, too. I sometimes use this board on recordings, and that works well, and have just one amp signal, and that will pretty much do everything. Or I'll do, as I said, split out the channels in the DAW and do it that way, but it's all pretty much the same idea. You know, distortion signal, clean signal, you get the notes, you can play chords, which I like to do, and you can play fast runs, and at the same time you can get some really wild and characterful fuzz or distortion or whatever your heart desires. There's plenty of demos on YouTube of like individual pedals just on their own. And I kind of wanted to give you something to think about in terms of how to set up a real world situation bass tone. And the amp I'm using, I'm just going through a really simple, it's the Ampeg SVT-VR. It is a VST amp sim. It's a nice sounding amp, but it's not really that important in this case. There's no distortion coming from that. It's just set up pretty basic, just kind of boring, clean tone. And a quick note on the bass. It is a Warwick Corvette Standard, made in Germany, 2006. 100% bridge pickup, tone, volume all the way up. You know the deal. I play in drop C on a 5-string, but the C is my low string. So I use custom gauge strings, they're extra light. I have the extended range goes up. C, G, C, F, A. With this tuning, I can play major and minor bar chords on 5 strings, which is cool. So here is my totally clean tone without the Sans amp. And that is just the amp sim with the Sans amp. So it just adds a little bit, a little bass, a little top end. It's a little clearer, a little bit scooped, and there's kind of a touch of grit on there. I actually have it rolled back. All right, and then let's play around with the distortion channel. All right, so here is the bass Big Muff dialed in just quickly, and this is just the general settings I use. Normal mode, no bass boost. I've got the volume on the line splitter matched to the clean signal, so when I turn that on and off, I'm not getting a big boost or cut in volume. And then the tone and sustain are just about where I like them on this pedal. Alright, next up, while we are in the muff zone, let's look at the Moore Triangle Buff. This is a Triangle Big Muff clone, and not quite as designed for bass, but let's give it a whirl. Thank you. That sounds pretty good to me. It's got a little more sustain than the bass Big Muff, a little less clarity, but it sounds nice with the clean blend. It works quite nice, and it's a little different character, but I like it. It's certainly a viable distortion fuzz pedal in this setup. All right, this is a new one here, the Keeley Fuzzbender. I've played it a little bit on guitar, and I like it a lot. So I haven't tried it on bass. What I will say is that I tested it before and after a buffer. This is kind of one of the old school style fuzzes where putting it after a buffer really does affect the tone. It doesn't necessarily make it sound worse, but hotter and different. It doesn't clean up as well, and it's maybe a little brighter. So I can probably dial that in anyways, but I haven't tested this on bass, and I will say it's a nice pedal. Well, we'll see how it sounds with the bass. This one also has a bias knob, which the Big Muffs don't, and that may be cool. I don't know. I've never played with a bias knob pedal on a bass, so it'll be new for me. Let's try it out. So I like that, actually. I mean, not surprising. It's a really nice fuzz pedal. But I don't know if I'd be using it on bass anytime soon. The bias knob is kind of fun for maybe for an effect, but I probably wouldn't do this general splitting thing. I think if I wanted sort of a vintage broken thing for maybe like a bass intro or a bass solo, get some kind of really messed up broken sounds out of it. It's pretty cool for that. But yeah, I think I would probably do that kind of on its own track as a whole separate thing. But it does work. I mean, if I was going to use it in a live situation, I could do it. I pretty much keep the bias, you know, all the way rolled off or just a little bit like I have it. It's got a lot of treble. It's got a lot of fuzz. I think you can see how I have it set up. But in this configuration, it sounds pretty good. I like it. I like it. I don't know if I like it any better than a Big Muff, but we'll see. It's certainly a very versatile fuzz, and I highly recommend it anyways. So, all right, so moving away from the fuzz and into the overdrive territory, I've got the Boss OD3. This is a flat EQ, generally. So it works well on bass. I have used it live. It doesn't cut off your low end, and it can get, you know, a fair bit of drive going, but also it's a nice, clean, articulate sound. If fuzz is too much, if distortion is too much, but you want some aggression, this is a good one, and it can go into reasonably high gain territory. So let's test it out. So I like this one. I do notice that if I pick really hard, it sort of squishes out, even kind of at the lower drive settings. Maybe the pickups are too hot, but these are single coils, I think. So I don't know. That's kind of a minor thing. It sounds good. It does. It feels like it sort of compresses a little bit. But overall, it's got a good sound. It works. It works. That's the only thing. I feel like I'm sort of running out of headroom on this right now. And it's not the most interesting. I mean, it's more subtle. So, that being said, it is a pretty good choice for a bass drive if it's the particular sound you're looking for, which it may or may not be. All right, here we have the infamous Moskey Golden Horse, going for over $10,000 on eBay. Well, not quite, but you get the drift. It is a Klon, or a Centaur, I should say, a Klon Centaur clone. So the Klon circuit has an accentuated mid-range, a mid-boost, mid-hump, and that can be cool for some stuff. It rolls off some of the low end, which you may not like on bass, but also has good headroom, and sometimes I kind of like rolling off the bass on. It can be useful for some things. It's good for boosting a big muff. I find that I really like the sound of a Klon boosted big muff. So that might be something fun to try, and I probably will at some point. I've tried it before, but I haven't made a video on it. Let's hear how this sounds on bass. Mm-hmm. not crazy about in this configuration. That being said, this pedal can be absolutely fantastic in certain contexts. I think on this pedal board for bass, it's okay. It's not bad, but it does have a pretty smooth sounding gain, but it's kind of, it's not really enough for what I want. And so I will give it a rating of okay. Okay, next up is the Joyo Ultimate Drive based on the Fulltone OCD. And I've used this one, I don't know if I've actually used it at a live show or on record, but so this one has a high-low switch, which changes the EQ curve of it, I think, or changes the functionality of the tone knob, I should say. The high mode boosts more high-end, the low mode boosts more, you know, sort of low mids, I think. And yeah, it's got a pretty good gain. This is another one that might be, you know, shine best in front of a tube amp. And so in this case, it might be a little dry, but it's a nice sounding pedal, and I'll just shut up and play it. You see if you like it. Say, if you want to get that kind of overdriven SVT sound, I think this pedal does a pretty good job of it. You know, it's like clean, but it does break up when you pick it hard. Let's push it up into high gain territory and see how it does there. So that's about optimized as far as I would use it. I do have the gain maxed out, but it's not a super high gain distortion. It's, you know, maybe in between. It's a lot higher gain than the overdrives I tried before, but I would call it sort of a low gain distortion. I think if you're going for more classic rock, you know, more sort of in between high gain and clean territory, it's pretty good for that, and it's not really quite right for the kind of music I play, but I like the sound, and this is actually, you know, I quite enjoy the sound of this. It's a good, I just say I like the sound a lot. I'm sorry. It's a good pedal. It feels good to me. It's responsive. It's not too oversaturated. I think that's an important thing for me. It is got good clarity, and not just in terms of the gain quality and the sound. I mean, everything in this setup with a clean blend is going to have pretty good clarity. But I also feel like even at a high gain setting, this is not, it's not too squishy. It's not too over compressed. It's got some give to it. It's got some natural response. I like the picking dynamics. Next up here, I've got the DoD Bone Shaker. It's a boutique metal zone. No, not really, but it does have a parametric EQ. It is a distortion pedal. This is another one that's in the low to mid gain offering. It's capable of some more high gain stuff, but I don't think it's really its strong suit. I think this is a very useful pedal for some things. I think it's a good boost or sort of a distortion layer. I wouldn't rely on it for a high gain sound on its own, but I think going into a tube amp for guitar purposes, I think it could be good for boosting a tube amp and sort of sculpting a metal guitar sound. And it works similarly well on bass, but I never got quite the perfect sound when I was trying this out, and I ended up going back to the Big Muff, which maybe that's just me. I do like fuzz. I like the Big Muff. It's fun. But this is a good pedal, and for the right player, it's got a lot of functionality. It's got a optional the depth knob, which is the middle knob on the top, works as a high pass, so you can roll off some of the lows with that, which is useful even on a bass. But you can also disengage it, and then it's got a 3-band parametric EQ and a distortion control. So let's check it out. Next up is the Digitech Grunge, the less infamous copy of the DOD Grunge. This is a fairly popular pedal for bass distortion. This is a digital distortion pedal. It is somewhat limited in what it can do, so if you like the sound, cool. If not, it's maybe not for you. So I actually like this one better than I remember. The input gain has to be set right, otherwise you won't really have much control over the distortion. And I think when I first tried this, I got a ton of feedback, and it seemed like no matter where I set the distortion, the grunge knob, it was just kind of out of control, and I kind of hated it and never used it again. But I think if you set the input gain right, I've got my Sans Amp actually running pretty low, so it's matched with essentially what is just coming out of the bass. So maybe if you have a pedal before it that can actually lower the volume, maybe, yeah, something to roll off the input gain. Because some of these, like my Metal Master, is like super high gain and really has no range. This one isn't nearly as bad. It definitely has more range on the gain. And I like the sound. It's kind of fuzzy. It's kind of messed up for a distortion, which I actually like. It's got some character. It's got a really powerful EQ that you should be careful with. It's kind of cool. It's tight. I like that even on my low strings, a lot of the lower gain, like the overdrive pedals, on the low strings, they just kind of don't, for whatever reason, they don't have much bite. And I like my low string to have some bite and some gnar to it. This brings the gnar, and it does provide some nice distortion, even in the lower ranges. It feels very compressed, but it also feels tight for that reason. It doesn't feel over-compressed, but it feels tight, and I think if you set the gain right, you can get enough dynamics so you don't have to feel like you have to pick too hard all the time to get bite out of it, but also you can, it's not just a brick wall, a super limited distortion. I don't ever really use this on anything, but coming back to it, I like it, and maybe I'll put it on some stuff in the future. Last but certainly not least here is my beautiful, hand-painted, limited edition, ultra-rare Behringer HM300 Boss HM2 paint job. You know what it is. It's a great pedal. Is it great for bass? Let's see. So I love this pedal, and it is, I think, really good on bass. It's fuzzy, but it's got some extra just bite and crispness to it that maybe a Big Muff doesn't. I would say if you're using it on bass especially, don't be afraid, as you can see, to take it out of full-on chainsaw mode, because there's actually a number of cool sounds that might be better suited for a bass. The lower gain offerings on it are actually pretty nice. The distortion knob on this one, you would know if you've played an HM2, but it goes from all the way off to basically 90% at when it's, let's just say. So here at the bottom is basically, it's off. It is off. And then as I go up just a little bit, you can actually hear a little click there where the distortion turns on. And keeping the distortion low on it can, it doesn't really change the gain that much. The distortion is so intense on this, but it will sort of clean up some of the noise, which can be good. And you can also use it with other pedals. This is actually, as I found out the other day, my Blade Valentine used this, Belinda did. So it's a good shoegaze pedal too. It's not just for Swedish death metal. Yeah, I really like it. I think it's good on bass. You need it in a blend situation like this. And if you're on the market for a really high-end HM2, there are some that have blend knobs on them, like Lone Wolf Audio makes one, and actually there's a number out there. And so, yeah, you can get an HM2 with a blend knob, or you can have a setup like I have here, and I think it works well. I like it. I really like the texture and the character of this one, and the HM300, while it's not the best clone out there, is pretty close, and, you know, it's for $20. I think it's close enough. It's certainly the cheapest option, and I like it, and you can just paint it black if you want. Thanks for watching, and I hope you've enjoyed this and learned it. And don't forget to comment what pedals you like and what pedals you use, and what you think of my setup. And maybe if you have any thing you think I could improve on this. I've been using this setup for years, and I've been working on tweaking it and improving it and trying out different distortion pedals for a long time. But if you have any great suggestions for me, feel free to let me know. And don't forget to like and subscribe, and stick around for more. Check out my other videos and let me know if you have anything you want me to cover and see on this channel. And I will see you in the next video. Cheers.